Hattie Kauffman is an Emmy Award-winning journalist. She made history in 1989 as the first Native American newscaster. Hattie's humble beginning started on the Nez Perce Indian Reservation in Idaho. In her book, Falling Into Place, Hattie shares how she overcame the wounds from abuse, alcoholism, and a life-shattering event.
Please welcome to the 700 Club, Hattie Kauffman. Hattie, it's so nice to have you here.
It is great. It's wonderful to be here.
This is a wonderful book. Falling Into Place is Hattie's recent book. Hattie, talk a little bit about your childhood. People looking at you today, I would think, would be stunned to know that you really came through some hard times as a child.
I did, but look at where we are. You're on the set, you put on the nice face, you put on makeup, you put on all this glamorous look, and I've been doing that for decades. Uh-huh. And then these are like revealing the secrets behind those early years. And I want to honor my parents and not say that they were terrible. They were, they went through a terrible time. Mm-hmm. And that left seven of us kids often alone. And picture seven kids in Seattle, and we are trying to make it on our own, basically, because one or the other parent is gone. And sometimes there's nothing to eat. You know, one day the furnace doesn't come on because nobody paid the bill.
And it's freezing cold.
The lights don't work. And the worst is when the water is shut off. But we got by. We struggled, but we got by. And we developed some spunk, I think, that came from that.
Well, there's always something tenacious that comes up in your character from experiences like that. You had an Aunt Teddy that had an impact on your life. Talk about her.
Yeah, she was a light. You know how we are called to be a light.
Yes.
And she was a light in our life. She was the one who taught me the 23rd Psalm. I had no idea what I was saying. I didn't know what it meant. She would have me repeat after her, "The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd." Mm-hmm. And so she was somebody that we sought. And there is actually an incident that I describe in my book when my older brother and sister take all of the others, there are seven of us, and we travel across town trying to get to Aunt Teddy's. Mm-hmm. Well, we've been alone for a few days. And, you know, I don't really know. Maybe I was five at the time, and so here you have seven kids, you know, basically crossing a city, taking two buses. We get on the wrong bus. We're lost. We're walking for miles like this little scraggly group. And to me, I really see it as a metaphor of how, you know, we are lost, and we are trying to find the light. And so that's why I put it in my book.
What were some of the struggles that became resident in your heart because of that initially in your life?
Well, I think, one, children of alcoholics learn to say, everything's fine, everything's fine. So you're covering up all the time. Two, I became a real workaholic. I was gonna make it on my own. Mm-hmm. Three, I think you grab onto the material and think, if I just have this, if I have that, I'll be okay. And you're never really satisfied. That was what happened to me anyway.
So Aunt Teddy had this light that really was evident to you, but you really didn't want what she had to offer.
Oh, not by the time I was a teenager. No, then I totally rejected her meanly. I'm half American Indian. This would have been, maybe early 1970. Mm-hmm. And I just decided, you know, that's the white man's God and we're Indian and why are you telling me this? And I, you know, because my Aunt Teddy was not the American Indian side. She was my father's sister.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. My mother was full-blooded Nez Perce. My father was not. He was white American. And I was angry. I was angry about everything that had happened and in our lives. And I took it out on an easy target. You know, it's you guys.
Yeah.
And
your God.
And your God. And I don't need any help.
Then you got doors opened for you and you wound up getting into a broadcast career. How did that happen?
I was at the University of Minnesota in Minneapolis. And I don't know if you remember the American Indian Movement, 1973, the takeover of Wounded Knee, all kinds of things were happening. And somebody from the radio station came to the American Indian Student Office and said, we'd like somebody to do Indian news. You know, and there was Dennis Banks, Clyde Belcourt, all these big tough guys to go interview. And I raised my hand and I volunteered and I was on the air the next day.
God had a plan.
God had a plan.
Yeah. So how did the light of what Aunt Teddy tried to share with you, the truth and the hope that was available to you, finally become a part of your life?
It took so long, decades. You know, I was 52 when I came to the Lord. And it was really, because of something that happened in my life. I had a 17-year marriage that collapsed suddenly and left me sort of reeling. And what I describe in my book, and I don't really want it to be a misery book of this childhood or a divorce book, but it's more of what happens when what you think you've built your life on isn't solid.
Rumbles, yeah.
Yes, we're sitting here on a set. You know, it's not real. What if it all fell apart?
Yes.
It's not real. And that's what I had built my life on. And so I'm 52 and I'm going through this divorce and I'm alone. And you get bad advice from people out there in the world.
Yeah.
As I say in my book, I have women saying, you know, go have an affair before you reconcile. I mean, it's bad advice.
Yes.
Go buy a new dress. Yeah. Luckily, somebody said to me, Hattie, read Isaiah 54. And I had to go find a Bible. And there's a wording in a few lines in Isaiah 54 that says, let God be your husband.
Mm.
And it just really, I heard it.
Spoke to your heart, yeah.
And I began to remember Aunt Teddy. And I began to think about the prayers that I said as a child. And I came to the Lord.
Yeah.
And my life has been completely different since then.
Yeah. These journeys are so, I guess, specific to each of us that we take along the way. You were a trailblazer for Native Americans in journalism, and I'm sure in many ways, as you reflect back now on what you write so eloquently about in your book, God used every one of those struggles, every one of those losses, every one of those challenges to give you what it took to be successful in what you're doing. How do you see that pattern?
You know, it's funny. Harry Smith, who was a longtime anchor at CBS and now at NBC, used to call me an empath. That was the name of that character on an old Star Trek show where she'd talk to you and she immediately knew what you were feeling. He said, Hattie's a natural empath. For some reason, every time she interviews somebody, she goes right there. And I think it's because probably my life, I had been right there.
Yeah.
You know, I had known suffering. You know,
you didn't
see it, but I had known it. And I was able to connect with people. And I think also, even before I came to Christ, I used to say, please help me tell this story. I mean, I didn't know what I was praying to. I didn't know what I was doing, but I would say that. And I think maybe that came through in some of my work.
What is your life today?
I've remarried to a wonderful man I met through church. I'm involved in Bible study fellowship, which I completely... It's a great
program.
Thing. It's, let me see. I write. I will be hoping that... that this book that I've written will reach out to some people who may not be believers, but will find something in there because it speaks to everything that we go through as people. What is home?
Yeah.
Where do you get your strength?
They say that our life experiences either make us bitter or better, and Hattie's have made her better. Hattie's memoir is called Falling Into Place. It's available wherever books are sold. A wonderful story of life. Visited by God and formed and shaped by Him. Thank you for being with us. It's great to have you here and to meet you.